the George Washington University to have inviting me for joining this conference and especially with Marlene. Second point, I apologize for my poor English. I am a poor Frenchman. Third point, I'm very happy to speak after Professor Bradin, as he is a historian and he was able to expose all the historical surrounding and data needed. Now I give you my anthropological look of the Covinter archives. The story begins with a Stalin idea who planned to annex the northeast and northwest of China, not only by infiltrating emissaries, but also by educating cohorts of young Negroes at the Communist University of the Eastern Workers, located in Moscow. The whole strategy was implemented with Beria as prime contractor, and the offensive date has been decided. But Stalin died exactly the day after, before, and everything was stopped. How all was organized, this is what I will try to explain to you. At the Comintern archive, in Moscow, one can find documents that show how Soviet communists tried to educate a circle of Uyghur revolutionaries who, once they returned home, were supposed to spread what they had learned at the USSR. The entire Uyghur population would then support the communist ideal, in this case, by turning away from China and joining the USSR. Today, I will be presenting a section of those archives, collection number 532. But first, I would like to draw your attention to the secret nature of their archives. For a long time, they were inaccessible. Then, because of difficulty of access, they were ignored as archives. Finally, as French historian Serge Polikov point out, they are ruled by the secret of opacity. The archives themselves reinforce secrecy. For example, people are referred to with false Russified names. The secrecy what makes research in the archives difficult must be kept in mind. I have a brilliant point I forgot to put it on. The French one, Serge Polikov, international communist, about the Comintern. And then, that's it. My goal was to study the Communist University of Oriental Workers and to analyze its work, the organization, failures and accomplishments between 1925 and 1935. First, the KUTV is a university for Soviet administration, like we have in France, ENA, ENA, for political person who after became like a French president and so on. KUTV was conceived as a school for Soviet administrators, even though no students were educated there. Instead, workers, especially farm workers, attended the university. The university was founded in Moscow in 1924 and continued until 1935. I focused on the years 1925 to 1935 because Uyghurs arrived in 1925. At the university, weekly or twice weekly meetings were held to discuss current issues. All workers were expected to attend. I found information for 50 workers who generally attended the meetings. Most were Uyghurs, 41 out of 50. Among the Uyghurs, 18 were farm workers, and 13 were factory workers. They were all born between 1891 and 1913, so were about 12 to 13 years old when they attended the university. I then examine the minutes in detail. I show you example of those minutes. Here it is. And I organized them around several themes. In fact, six themes. Those minutes, one is in Russian and the other in Uyghur language. There are both of them in the archives. And it's always the same. You have the name of president, the name of the secretary, how many people attend the meeting, how many people were absent, and so on and so on. So first thing, as it was said before, the organization was met with two fronts. It's through a careful reading of the meeting minutes that I discovered that Comintern had decided to invade Sinhan from two different positions. The first was in northern Xinjiang, as you can see here on the map, to the north of the Tian Shan Mountains, in a district called Zhongari. All documents related to this area are in collection 532, part 1. The second was near the city of Kashgar in southwestern Xinjiang province and was referred to as the Kashgar cycle. All documents concerned this area are in collection 532, part 2. Second theme, recruitment. How they are recruited the students. Let us look at how and why KUTV students were recruited. Generally speaking, all students were sent to the university through IKKI, Executive Committee of Communist International. However, it seems that the Uyghur people were not covered by the school. In March 1925, the president of the KUTV asked Moscow to send a group of 35 students from Zhongari. The reason evoked was that since 1912, there had been a revolutionary Dzungar nationalist movement that was not overseen by the Komsomol. You all know about the council. Okay. Unchecked, their activities developed into a sort of pan-Turkist Islamism. It thus became obvious revolutionary activities might be carried out in Xinjiang, in southern Xinjiang, but also that future leaders would have to be trained at KUTV. According to the minutes of a meeting that took place in 1927, the meeting was to discuss KUTV students from Xinjiang. I quote, "It appears that out of the class of 12 students, 7 were Uyghur, 2 were Dungan, two were Kalmuk and one was Kazakh. The Kalmuk students came after having been officially assigned there. The rest came from the Central Asian Republics, in other words, the USSR, or from Mongolia. That means that no one from Eastern Turkestan, also known as Xinjiang, had been recruited by the Comintern. Why then this account titled Declaration Concerning Students of Kayum TV Coming from Xinjiang? Who profited from this lie? The president of the party gave us an explanation. Comrades who presented themselves as Uyghur were in reality coming from southern Kazakhstan. In other words, it was the same. And I show you. I also found evidence for another method of recruitment that seems particularly strange. A student who has been expelled from the KUTV, has been admitted to the Lenin School under a false name. This former KUTV student then recruited the young people in Kyrgyzstan, who later were admitted to the KUTV, as ordered by the Comintern. Another group of students had been recruited 2 years earlier from another former student and admitted without any outside verification. These two groups then had a very violent dispute, after which an official explained that the Uyghur group must be divided in three groups according to how they were recruited. The first would be students who joined the university by their own efforts. Among them were Uyghurs from Central Asia who would never go to Xinjiang and who wished to work in Central Asia. The second group would be those recruited by the former student without any outside verification. The third group would consist of very young and unemployed and inexperienced Uyghurs who were officially recruited by the KUTV staff. The rigidity of the Comintern behavior seems to reflect their uncomfortable situation. Third thing. There were, in fact, many instances of inter-ethnic rivalries. First, at the Uyghurs and the Dungan entertained an almost visceral antagonism. The Uyghur people see the Dungan more as Han Chinese than brother in Islam. Then, among the Dungan themselves, there were open fights arising from the deep and well-known division between the Masanjinov and the Suleimanov clans, often mentioned in the meeting accounts. Finally, I should note that at one point there were a large number of Chinese students at the KUTV. Between 1925 and 1930, more than 1,200 Chinese students were trained at the KUTV. Meeting accounts show that Turkestanese students, including Uyghur, joined together with Chinese students, then separated, then again got back together. In conclusion, I would say that the KUTV was an authoritarian institution in which secrecy, supervision, denouncements, criticism, and self-criticism were key words. However, at the same time, it was a place full of deep resentment and inter-ethnic rivalries. Fourth thing, teaching. Let us look at the teaching provided at the KUTV. Most of you are like me, teacher at the university, and when I read that, wow. Over a three-year period, students attended a variety of classes. In 1932, yes, in one section of the A section, there were 23 professors for 12 subjects and 30 students, which is quite important. A year later, there were 28 professors for 30 students. Acknowledging this mismanagement, the decision was made to reduce the number of teachers to 14 or 15. In the first year, students studied several different subjects for a total of 1,341 hours. Subjects included political economy, history of Bolshevik Party, history of the revolutionary movement, military tactics, languages, and geography. In the second year, they studied 9 subjects for a total of 1,208 hours. Subjects included history of the revolutionary movement, political economy, history of Bolshevik Party, geography, military tactics, history of Communist International, agriculture theory, Russian language, and Communist Party structure. In the third year, last year, they studied 8 subjects for 1,130 hours. You can imagine it's in fact a lot of hours. I made a comparison with the French university, and it's less small, more or less in French. Subjects included materialistic dialectics, history of Communist International, Communist Party structure, geography, agricultural theory, Leninism, youth movement, and professional development. In 1933, all the classes were added, such as the origin of Islam, 30 hours, the philosophy of Islam, 30 hours, the Soviet movement in China, 40 hours, and modern tongue instruction, 28 hours. We thus understand that from this time on, the Comintern intended to adapt teaching to the students. Living condition, 5-7. The course load just described was not designed for backward, or at least very, or at very least, illiterate students. But they were. They couldn't speak even Uyghur, they couldn't speak Russian, they couldn't speak and read anything. Therefore, the students faced enormous difficulties. Generally speaking, the students were young, I told you from 20 to 30 years old, and were more accustomed to rural life than urban life. One might easily imagine that during the years 1925 to 1935, living conditions at KUTV would be restrictive and even abusive. The young men were without any female company, and they were forbidden to contact their family contacts. They were also punished for breaking internal rules. Accused, they then had to carry out self-criticism. Moreover, the so-called workers were identified by a number, but by a specified name. And that was given to them when they were admitted at the university. And I show you. No, this picture of them. This is let me see, Lenin School. Well, here, you see the name surname of the Kalyugi. All are Russian, some Russian. An original name remains very rarely in the documents, perhaps once or twice in all the documents. It's very difficult to find out the original name. So that means that their own identity was wiped out. The real names appeared in only one place in some of two in the minutes, under the rubric Genin last name. We are also aware that students were 3 to 9 per room. In 1932, for example, 5 rooms housed 3, 5, 6, 6, and 9 students, respectively. One can imagine how difficult this would have been for young men without female company, used to nomadic life, or used to living in adobe houses with a central camp bed for the whole family. It must be older. And the same with the meals. They were fed with Russian meals. That means potatoes, bread, and buckwheat, rather than noodle, rice, and mutton. Many students became ill, and I noticed examples of liver disease, pneumonia, and brain disease. Twice a year, students receive clothes, especially a warm, heavy overcoat, which could later be bartered for service. Leisure time was organized and obligatory, including short excursions, theater, and cinema. In 1933, in order to attract more students, the party committee decided to give one free evening plus the following day each week for cultural activities. And you remember the number of classes they had, so quite different. 6 points, bad behavior. Many instances of bad behavior were cited in the minutes. Lies about ethnic identity, social class, fights, expression of regionalism and nationalism, or personal initiatives. By looking at the opposite of these behaviors, we get a description of the ideal man desired by communists. The ideal man should be young, ethnic, well-educated, multilingual, impartial, honest, calm, obedient, devoted to the community, party informed, selfless, motivated, active, of good family background, respect for class, and without family ties or foreign relations. Is this ideal man or fantasy? I don't know. Results. In 1932, 8 students out of the total of 36 were dismissed from the KKUTV and sent to work in the factories located outside of Moscow. A year later, only students graduated, and of those 5, only 3 became genuine revolutionary activists and were sent to Xinjiang. So altogether 3. Third year students did not have much more to offer in the way of revolutionary activists. Only 2 out of 6 students were said to be available for going some work in their own country. Under the circumstances, the party organizer asked to 6 or 7 more students to be sent from Central Asia so that after an intensive year, they could be sent back home. In December 1933, meeting accounts offered the description of 7 students. 6 have been dismissed from the KUTV and sent to work in factories of Moscow. One must be severely punished for lying to protect two of his friends who had foreign contacts. In 1934, minutes show that meetings changed to become more like production meetings in which teachers and students exchange questions, compliments, and criticism without any distinction of class or status. A new reform was planned for 1935 concerning the recruitment of staff. Also, future students of the KUTV would also undergo training in factories. Neither of these plans were ever carried out. This is Lux Hotel where they were living 2 years.